Sixth meeting of the town board. We have public hearings, workshops, and our regular meeting. Please join me while we pledge allegiance to our flag.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, so, hi, Joe. May I have a motion to accept the minutes of the September 12th and 14th meetings?
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. We have three continued public hearings on the agenda. The first is Local Law H for rural events. And I just would like to inform the public that we have received comments from the Roosevelt Fire Department. And so we'll be looking, I will be asking for a motion to modify the agenda by pulling that resolution to adopt that local law. That would be resolution number one.
I make a motion.
And a second?
Second.
And all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. So at this time, I'd like to open the public hearing for the rural events law.
Good evening. My name's Dan Nichols. I'm the Chief of Department of the Roosevelt Fire District, 830 Violet Avenue here in the town of Hyde Park. Thanking the board for taking a more detailed look at the requirement for the rural event venues. The fire district is happy that the town is actually looking into something like this, which has been going on in other areas of the state, which has become a big impact to local services, fire service included. My comments are, I think, helpful in cleaning up the law instead of obstructing the law. In areas such as what a certificate of occupancy would actually be considered for in the event of using buildings that are not intended currently as a place of public assembly. What the term temporary or occasional use would mean, is that four times a week, four times a year, Saturdays, whatever it may be. Mainly our comments are regarding impact, the impact that we would have on the rural character of where these locations are intended to be placed. Some of the roadways, I'm just going to anecdotally say Forest Drive, Folk Hill Road, South Cross Road, some areas where high traffic volumes would be problematic for us, both getting people there to enjoy the event, hopefully, and hopefully we don't have to come, but if we do, it's kind of hard for us to get in there. So look forward to working with the board to continue on the comments, and if you have any questions, feel free to reach out to me. Thank you.
Thank you, Chief.
Thank you.
Would anyone else like to speak on the rural events law? Okay, may I have a motion to continue the public hearing to October 3rd?
I make the motion.
And a second?
Second.
And all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay, thank you, Chief. We'll be working on that.
We're going to have the attorney for the planning board.
Oh, I'm sorry, yes, okay. Yeah, our town attorney is going to defer this to the planning board attorney, and she's going to work on it because she's actually the person who has composed the original law. So we'll be consulting with her this week and talking to you. Good, okay. Alrighty, so then we are also continuing the solar law. We've been working on this for quite some time and have continued to receive comments. The last one was this Sunday. So the town attorney has revamped the law yet again. And so he's provided that to everyone today. So we're going to go ahead and continue that public hearing as well, but would let anyone like to come up and speak on the just state your name, your address, and please limit your comments to 3 minutes.
Absolutely. Hi. It's a pleasure to meet you guys.
Hi.
My name is Jason Lieberman, and I would just first like to thank you guys for all the work you've done thus far in regards to solar and the solar law, the impending solar law. I am a solar developer interested in working with the community and helping the town and the constituents of the town reduce their utility costs and providing an alternative green source of energy for the town. One question I just had that for my own clarification, I was slightly confused just in the delineation between, the freestanding solar energy systems and ground-mounted, and then what would be considered solar farms. And just like kind of those, that is my pretty much the only question that's...
Yeah, I can answer.
You can answer.
Yeah.
I mean, basically, the freestanding solar systems, the law was designed to apply to a low-intensity location of a solar system on a residential property where they wouldn't be on the roof, but they'd be somewhere on the property.
Right.
Or a commercial property where they wouldn't be on the roof, but they would be on the on the grounds of the property. Those have the potential for slightly more impact than the roof, so those go through a special permit process. The solar farms are the large-scale applications of the solar law to allow for much more expanded such as uses such as you would probably be proposing, and those
I don't know yet, but
review process, and that's
yeah, absolutely. Yeah, no, I just...
Okay, yeah, okay.
I think that answers my question.
Okay.
That's great. Thank you so much. Yep. I appreciate it.
Thank you.
Mr. Thanis?
Supervisor Warr, Town Board, Mike Athanas, 1487. How's everybody tonight?
Good evening. Good. And you?
I wasn't aware there was an amendment to it. I thought there was...
Well, it just happened. Sunday night, we had a resident email some comments, so Warren got dug right in and made some changes.
Could I ask what the amendment is?
The change that I made, in addition to the other changes that were made from previous comments that were sent to the board, is in paragraph 135, and it regards the height limitations, and it was pointed out to us that by prohibiting the maximum height for a rooftop or solar-mounted facility to the height of the building, that might be too restrictive. And that might interfere with other sections of our law. So the way I've changed that was, is a rooftop and building-mounted solar collectors may exceed the maximum height prescribed for the principal uses for applicable zoning districts, but only to the extent necessary to achieve the intended purpose of the solar collected. Those would go through a site plan review process.
Okay.
So the idea was that they'd be permitted to exceed the maximum height of the building, but only where the planning board finds that the height is the least they need to achieve the solar purposes.
Okay, that has no effect on the farm, a solar farm.
No, it has nothing to do with the solar farm. Type thing. That was only for the.
Okay.
You know. But you did make some other changes.
I did make some other changes to the solar farm
regarding the decommissioning bond.
Yes.
That was in the version
that was
out
in the
on
previous
Friday.
Version, yeah. And that's basically. On, I can go over those quickly. I changed in paragraph 138, the perimeter fencing requirement in paragraph A, I changed from 8 to 7.5 feet, so that's less onerous.
I think you should have kept it at 8 because deer have a tendency to jump at 8, and you don't want a deer running around there.
Well, you know, I can't make everybody happy.
Yeah, I know. But that's not a critical thing.
In subparagraph G, I require that all applications for the farm be accompanied by a decommissioning plan to be implemented upon abandonment or cessation of activity or in conjunction with the removal of the structure, which shall be reviewed by the town board and its consultants. Clarified paragraph I-1 so that they're removed within a period of 1 year, within 6 months after the date of the expiration of the use.
Warren, I'm sorry, can you go into the mic, please?
I'm sorry.
Thank you.
The expiration of the use, and in paragraph H2, and this was in response to comments by other potential developers, that all above ground and below ground equipment, conduits, structures, fencing, and foundations shall be removed
to, from the site to a depth of at least 3 feet below grade. And paragraph four, the site shall be restored to as natural condition as possible within 6 months of the removal of all equipment, structures, and foundations, and such restoration shall include, where appropriate, restoration of the surface grade and soil after removal of all equipment, and revegetation of the restored soil areas with native seed mixes. And then on paragraph five, in response to the comments about potential inability to obtain a removal bond, I provided an alternative to the bond, where the solar farm operator or owner could enter into a decommissioning agreement with the town, that it will all the equipment will be removed within a certain period of time. Otherwise, the town would have the right to come in and actually remove it and charge it back against the property. Again, that was in response to the prior comments that we had, and those are the only changes that we made to the law.
That's been a hot discussion, the removal of the equipment, and consensus seems to settle down onto like forming an escrow account or something of that nature, where a little bit of money is put away. An engineer determines, you know, with future expenses, what the removal or decommissioning would cost, and then a small escrow amount each year over a 20 to 30 year period would more than less cover it.
I hadn't seen a law that had that particular provision in it.
It's a possibility.
What I looked at were the comments that we got, and I was referred to certain other laws. So I put these two alternatives, either a bond or this agreement. I think the town board would have a certain amount of flexibility on a case-by-case basis to work out something with the developer as to how they want to deal with the decommissioning. And the planning board, when they approve it, could also weigh into that. And so I think we have enough flexibility.
I think you're right, yes. Yeah. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Thanis. Would anyone else like to speak on the solar law? Okay, so...
Hold on, we got one.
Oh, I'm so sorry. Oh, hi, Michael.
Michael Dupree, Planning Board Chairman. I just want to thank the board for taking this law on. Sometimes in the minutiae and the details, it gets lost what the overall purpose of this was, and that is to allow people who have large enough lots to produce this kind of energy can make some money off of it, basically. We are incentivizing both new technologies and green energy, but more importantly, we're also allowing people with large lots to not have to think when we have a big pressure again for housing everywhere, that we can keep some of these because there's an income stream off of it. So I applaud the board for taking this on, because I think that there are plenty of people who have large properties in the green belt. I know I've talked to Mr. Thanis before, and I've had two other people just speak to me about it. And right now we're kind of on hold waiting for the law. So I can't wait for the law, because this will be an interesting new field. All my colleagues and I are eager to have the first kind of case through. In reference to what Warren just said, I think that there is going to be some flexibility, and we're eager to see what that's going to be like in the first case. So thank you again.
Thank you.
Michael?
Let's see, Mr. Horan just came in. We're in the public hearing for the solar law. Oh, okay. The amended copy, town clerk, just let me know the amended copy is over on the table.
Sure. I had an opportunity to go over the amended copy and look at it a little bit more in detail than the last time. Just a couple of comments. With respect to the solar farms, which is particularly what my client is mostly concerned with, there's a question. I don't know if it's the intent of the law or not to have the requirements of 130-6 apply to solar farms or not. As I read 130-6, it seems to contemplate an accessory type use for freestanding solar panels whereas a solar farm would be considered to be a primary use. One of the provisions in 130-6 subdivision 8, it talks about that the freestanding solar panels cannot occupy more space than the total area of the building on the lot. So if you have a solar, if that section was intended to apply to a solar farm on a vacant, where you installed a solar farm on the vacant lot, it'd be kind of unworkable since you don't have that upper limit. I believe what should happen in that case would be the typical building coverage provisions would apply. I believe in the Greenbelt districts, it's 15% would be the building coverage. The other question has to deal with the provisions related to collective solar. It's unclear whether or not collective solar is included within the definition of solar farm or not. I would think that in many cases it would be. If that's the case, then collective solar would only be limited to the Greenbelt area rather than, you know, all the different areas of the town. And a collective solar is kind of a very special scenario where, in essence, you have various people, you know, combining to take ownership of the property. The other issue would be with respect to setbacks. There's a the definition of setback talks about side yards and rear yard setbacks. In the case of a solar farm, on a vacant property, there doesn't seem to be any front yard setback. I would assume that that would mean that it would be the setback for a primary use. And then with respect to 130-5, it talks about solar panels, the height of solar panels being limited to the principal, the height of the principal use on the lot.
We actually just went over that. That's already been fixed.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. So the question was, how did that apply on accessory buildings?
Maybe I interrupted. Warren, did you want to just address that? We did make one. I think Warren made one more update to the law just today.
It would be the same standard for an accessory.
Yeah, it would. But that it says that it can exceed the maximum height prescribed, but only to the extent necessary to achieve the intended purpose.
Yeah, no, the question I had was, as drafted, if you put a solar panel, say, in a garage or something like that, would it be limited? I mean, would it be the height for the accessory building, or would you be permitted to go to the height for the principal structure on the lot? There was some confusion with respect to that. With respect to small scale solar, the limitation here is 10 kilowatts. NYSERDA uses 12 kilowatts in their unified solar permit. I have just a couple of one or two other minor comments, which I'll put in writing.
Yeah. You know, at the last meeting, you were going to put everything in writing. We never got it. So
I had lost it. So
okay. So if you want these considered, I'd be happy to.
I have it in writing. Right.
And I think we can either address or respond.
And I thank the board for responding to the comments that were made previously, particularly with respect to the bonding requirement. I think what's in the revised local law is eminently workable. Thank you.
Thank you. I know. We're anxious to get this passed. We've been working on it for quite some time. So,
yeah, and as we've mentioned, I think it's maybe a work in progress where we get some version in place and then we can always update it in the future as the technology mm-hmm. evolves.
Tweak it.
Yeah. Okay. All righty. So would anyone else like to speak on the solar law? Okay, so may I have a motion to continue the public hearing to October 3rd?
So moved.
And a second?
Second.
And all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay.
Although I think in our resolution, we're resetting the public hearing for the 17th.
I know. We're setting it for the 17th?
On the new version of the law.
Okay.
But we may now have another new version of the law. We'll see when I see the comments.
Oh, you're right. It is.
It should be the 3rd or the 17th.
No, you're right. The resolution says October 17th. Okay, so motion to
17th.
To the 17th, but okay. All right. So
second,
and all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay. The last public hearing on our agenda is the Local Law J, stale applications, which we are also planning on continuing. But would anyone like to speak on Local Law J, amending Chapter 96 and 108 of the Town Code to provide for the abandonment of certain stale applications before the Town of Hyde Park Planning Board?
Just so you know, this is the same version of the law that we had last time. The only addition that we've made to it is we've now made it apply to subdivision applications. So that's the only change. So the Planning Board, if this is passed, will now have the ability to require that applications that have become stale by virtue of non-processing of the application before the Planning Board can be notified to come before the board and get the application moving, or else they might be subject to having the application be dismissed and have to be resubmitted if they want to move forward with this. That's the only change. Everything else is the same.
And that was modification was made based on the Planning Board input, right?
Yes, yeah, they requested that be put in.
Okay. Okay, so would anyone like to speak on this? Okay, so we will then continue the public hearing to October 3rd.
I'll make the motion.
I think, again, doesn't that one say the 17th? Am I wrong? Maybe.
17th.
Does it say that in there?
Yeah, in the resolution.
Oh, it does. Okay.
It does.
So to the 17th.
Make that motion.
And
second.
Second, and all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Okay. So that's it for our public hearings. We do have some workshops. The first item is the Transit Advisory Group update. So I'd like to welcome our representation at that committee. Please join us up here. Hi.
Hi, how are you?
Good. So we have our county legislator, Hannah, here. Hannah Black, and?
Yes. Paul Donnelly, reside at 33 Greenbush Drive here in Hyde Park.
Okay. So can you give us an update on your experiences with the organization?
Sure. Yeah. Well, we'll start it off with Paul is serving on the advisory transit committee of the county. Mm-hmm. So it started with him, and I've been doing some follow-up with some understanding of what our needs are, and some of the constituents of mine have actually reached out to me with some potential recommendations for changes. So Paul's going to bring this back to the advisory committee, and then we'll see how the county decides to move forward with it. In the meantime, after we give you the updates and concerns, you may feel free to share what you feel, suggestions that you may want to add. It doesn't have to be tonight. It can be in the near future.
So can you just actually give us a little review about what the Transit Advisory Committee is?
Yep. Yes, of course. That's what I'm going to do.
Oh, good.
Yeah. So the reason why this advisory committee was set up was to field suggestions and recommendations in terms of mass transit from the given for different municipalities here in the county. And some of the things they're going to be working on is the first would be an application on your smartphones, and that's for the schedules, and that's coming hopefully be on board on this November at the end of the year. Also in the works is kiosks on the buses, so you can pay and get your tickets right when you board the bus.
Just so everyone's clear, this is for Dutchess County Loop System, correct?
Yeah.
Yeah, just so, I don't think many people would know that. So we're talking about the Dutchess County Loop and, yeah, and the transit and the timeframes and all that. Perfect.
All right. Yeah, and the other thing that the county is also working on are new bus signs. And I just found out from Hannah, our legislator, Black, that they want to have those signs set up in January, but it's probably looking to be more towards the spring. So so after going to a few of the meetings and talking to residents and community members, some suggestions that we have, you know, I'll go over a couple and give them to Hannah. First would be displaying the transfer stations on the map and schedule to making it easier for to people know where the transfers are located. You can talk about the stop. And then another thing is to be the bus drivers should make an announcement before the transfers, kind of facilitate, you know, people getting off and going on to another route or whatever. So, and another one was another stop, but I think Hannah can talk a little bit more about that.
Well, just to kind of back it up a little bit, the Transit Advisory Group, really, it's interesting because one of the functions of government is really planning. I mean, most of the time as residents, we live in the present, but the government is really supposed to be anticipating future needs as well. And I think that was the purpose of the advisory committee, is to anticipate not just what residents currently need, but the future. Mm-hmm. And so that was kind of what you were charged with, I believe, is to kind of go out to the community, ask them what their needs are, and then come back, and so that they can bring that data into their long-term plans, which Hannah and I spent, you know, several hours with Cynthia Ruiz getting a review. And I mean, it's really rather a complex entity, the Loop bus system. And I think our future portends that we'll be relying on it more. So it's pretty impressive, actually, all the coordination that goes into it.
Yeah, speaking to that, absolutely. So I did just put up one of the slides because I thought that it was the one that probably made the most sense and was easy enough to go over as far as the future plans are concerned. So basically, we've already purchased half of the fleet, the new fleet of Loop buses that are going to be ADA compliant. And the idea of it is that the newer buses will last longer than our current ones, is what I the information I received during the meeting. So towards 2017 and 2018, we'll be replacing 8 more buses with an entire fleet that has been replaced. So this is a great a great piece of it. And as we were speaking with Cynthia, that they go into great lengths. Part of the planning is securing grants to cover some of these costs. As you can see, so they're projecting 80% from the federal government and 10% from the state and 10% from local. So, and they're going to continue on securing grants as well for the future of our public transportation. So that's one of the pieces of it. And so the other piece was to get recommendations from citizens and residents as to what they would like to see. So basically, from what I've gathered too as well, is making our Loop bus system user friendly. So part of those recommendations, one of the things that the county will be doing is putting up those bus signs throughout the county. They're projecting that to be in the spring once again. And the other piece of it is they're going to have this mobile app, so you can check to see the bus schedule and if the buses are running on time. So part of what we had concluded was it would be helpful, once again, Paul had mentioned having the transfer stops actually easily identified, you know, and flagged on the map, and also communication from the bus drivers to the users on the Loop bus. Basically, if you're going from Hyde Park down to Hopewell, you're going to have a couple of transferovers. So Knowing how to get there is really important, and it's not easy to figure out through the map by yourself. So having that additional information and communication is really important, much like a subway system, right? So you get the announcements prior to the transfer over. So that was one of our thoughts. The other thought was potentially adding an additional bus stop to the route in Hyde Park on East Market Street between the Hyde Park Heights apartment and Mill Run South condos, where that nice lovely benches. It's my understanding that there's a large amount of people who access the bus in that area, so with safe sidewalks and with a nice area to sort of sit or wait, that could potentially be a good place for the bus stopping, adding to the route at least, you know, once a day or some amount of times per week. So we'd have to see how the county would respond to that, the transit administrator. So that was one of our thoughts. And then the only additional thought that we had come up with was, since there's going to be an app for displaying the schedule and figuring that out better, why not have an app for purchasing monthly bus passes? This would be a future goal in my mind. Once again, that's something that the county is going to have to sort out and see what they're going to end up doing. But I would think that by committing to a monthly bus pass and buying it, for the long run, it's going to sustain the system better. And
how much is it to ride the bus now?
$350? I think so, right?
Yeah.
Define that, yeah, specifically.
I think that one of the things that I got out of our meeting with Cynthia is that, you know, they are trying to facilitate higher use, because it's much more, you know, who wants to see an empty bus go by? But I think part of it is getting the information out to the people, pushing that information out, because how do you know, what your options are? And I think that right now there are two, twice a day the bus goes through Hyde Park on 9 and 9G, is that right?
And you can always flag the bus as it's coming by if you're not at the station, but you have to put you can't just wave. It's not like a taxi wave, it's a direct hand up, almost like a salute.
Yeah.
Has the advisory board rode on the buses and spoke to the people on the bus to ask them what they need to improve the system and what is most needed? I mean, what we think maybe apps are most needed, but maybe that's not the case. Maybe it's you know, X, Y, or Z. Have we been on the buses and spoke to the people?
I haven't had the opportunity to go on a bus yet, but the last meeting I attended, there were a couple people that rode the bus regularly, and their concerns are more down in like the Wappingers area. Okay. They weren't.
Well, I think that they did a pretty complete survey.
They did.
That's again from Cynthia Ruiz's presentation, that they had handed out a survey.
Oh, good.
And given that to the passengers. And I think the other important thing is that you know, just that people have the link to the Dutchess County government. That's where you can find out the information on the runs. I mean, because we don't have it's a loop, but it takes a long time to get from the south of Dutchess all the way to the north. So it's not exactly, you know, something that you can just kind of, you have to plan your day around it.
Right.
The other important part that we won't go into too deeply but we can certainly, I can send the information to you and we can work on getting it out to, is the ADA compliance.
Yep.
Paratransit service. So that's good. That's more specific to if you need to sign up for it in advance, and there are online forms that can be submitted through online. Basically, it's a service additional to the Loop Bus system, where if you have a medical need and medical support, you're able to, you know, with a wheelchair, able to get on and access it easily. And they will go up to 3/4 mile off route. However, if you are beyond that, you can certainly call, and they will arrange it case by case. So they'll send somebody out to do a site visit to determine if they can in fact handle going off route route depending on how far it is, and factor that into their schedule. They're very, they try to, one of their main goals is staying on schedule as close to possible, so that's key. So, but they do have a number of, it's not just one ADA bus that does this. It's a number, it's a fleet, so.
So it's a nice complement to the actual bus service. So, you know, the town does pay for a dial ride service, which is once a week, and that is something that has to be prearranged. And it's really quite reasonable, too. I can't remember, $5 or something like that. And but it's all available on their website and lots of information, because, as Hannah mentioned, it's not just the dial ride. There's these other alternatives. If you have some sort of disability, you can make arrangements to be picked up, and it's really pretty complete service, but it does require planning.
Yes, it does require planning, and certainly, you know, if there were to be any questions, you can call the county with the transportation department, the transportation administrator. She's very helpful and willing to answer any of that. And
does it have its own web page, or is it only linked through the Dutchess County?
It's linked through the Dutchess County.
I'd like to put that on our own website, though.
Yeah, okay.
Just that link.
You know, we can do that.
Herb is, we can relay that to Steve.
Send that.
I think that's really the most important thing I think people can do, is have the information as to when, how to use it.
Well, that's very important too, and that's another big piece, is that if anybody was to have a question on how to transfer from you know, Hyde Park to a Poughkeepsie station to going down towards, let's say, Wappingers, you can certainly call the public transportation department, and they'll walk you through it. They have no problem with that. That's a service that they offer. So I think that that's really important for people to understand. There's no intimidation there. We fully want to help with that. So then the last little piece is it's actually not a county service. But it is a not-for-profit. It's called Friends of Seniors of Dutchess County, and basically you call them and you set it up prior to, as well, with registering with them, and they can take seniors who once again, they can't take seniors who have wheelchairs just yet and oxygen tanks, but because due to medical reasons. But, you know, they do take a number of seniors. They service about 345 seniors throughout the county each year. So it's a great alternate transportation if you need. My understanding is that they will take you to your doctor's appointment, and then someone will be there shortly after as well to pick you up if you need such a service and you're not able to, you know, perhaps wait a little while. So I wanted to add that in there as well. So I can give you that information to put on your website.
So it's called Friends of Seniors?
Yeah, okay, Friends of Seniors.
That'd be great.
Yep.
Good.
That's it.
Okay. Well, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Right,
okay.
Thank you, guys.
Yep.
Thanks, guys.
Okay. So we have the EAF for the rural events law and the local and the solar law. So
yes.
Do you want to go through those right now?
Yeah, Warren? Very quickly.
Okay.
Basically, I realize that until we pass the resolution, we can't make a determination of significance. So I have prepared the part two of the full environmental assessment form for the rural event venues. We haven't, and basically I have answered each question in terms of possible impacts on land, geological features, surface water, groundwater, impact on flooding, air, plants and animals, agricultural resources, aesthetic resources, historic and archaeological resources, open space and recreation, critical environmental areas, impact on transportation, impact on energy, impact on noise, odor, and light, impact on human health, consistency with community plans, and community character impacts, all in the negative for both laws. Basically, one, we haven't received any comments of the environmental impacts of either the either law, and we're considering the impacts of only passing the law. And in each case, the rural event law requires a special use permit, and there will be an environmental review of the site of the specific proposal done by the planning board. So we will answer this at the end of the process, but I feel that there are no potential significant environmental impacts in the passage of either law. If we hear otherwise at the next meeting, we can always make a different determination.
Okay, so we'll just basically defer these until
it will be
final,
in the resolution
until it's
adopting
final.
It.
Okay, yes. Sounds good.
And if anybody has any board members have any questions or comments about part two of the AF, we can resolve those at the next meeting.
Mm-hmm. So something I've been thinking about is just going back to the solar law for a minute. I was reading an article about Marbletown's local law, and there were some comments in that article regarding the capacity of the lines that serve the solar, and that there is some limitation. Is that anything that you have read of or heard of?
Do you know what I'm talking about? I can look into that. I wasn't.
I think that that's something that the applicant that wants to build a farm would have to, you know, look into.
Those would all be addressed or especially.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, but it was just that was they had a law that they had developed and then they pulled it for various reasons. But that was just something that was a caveat that, you know, a lot of communities are passing them, but in some ways they're limited the uses by the limited capacity of the. We're really focusing in on the very detail. The longer it goes.
You can send me a copy of that article. Okay. I'll look at Marbletown's, but not.
I think it was Marbletown. Okay. It's either Marbletown or Rochester.
Okay. Oh, Rochester.
The town of Rochester.
Yeah.
I think it was Marbletown.
Yeah, I wasn't sure. I think I couldn't find the town of Rochester. I don't think there is a town of Rochester.
There is a town. It's not the city of Rochester. It's the town of Rochester. Okay, so moving on, we're now going to have public comment.
Actually, before we do that, I was wondering if, go ahead.
Yeah, but I was going to say that Warren could give an update. I know we have a number of Conley Drive people here, and I thought before we have the public comment on the resolutions that Warren could give an update on what has transpired since our last meeting.
Okay. At the last meeting, a resolution was passed by the town board which basically determined that there were not grounds to contest the siting of this facility in the Connolly Drive subdivision based upon overconcentration, as that term is defined by the statute and the decisional law interpreting that, but that we would, the town board would exercise its option to recommend an alternative site for the facility, and the town board did recommend the Pines Woods Drive site, which was something that was recommended, by the actual neighbors had given us a list of possible alternative sites, and that was number one on the list. That site has been rejected by the Anderson School, and no reasons were given for the rejection, but I did contact Mary Espy at the Anderson School to see if I could determine the reasons why that site was determined to be unsuitable. And this is the information that she provided to me. First, that there is water in the basement. Two, that there are signs of mold in the basement which require remediation. Third, there is a creek in the backyard which raised safety concerns for the residents. Four, the deck is severely rotten and compromised and needs to be completely replaced. Five, the windows are not energy efficient and will need to be replaced. Six, the topography of the site is all rock and will prevent the expansion of the septic system to meet OPDWDD requirements. Seven, the roof needs replacement. Eight, the driveway has steep slopes and inclines, which will make maintenance difficult. And I believe she indicated traveling more difficult, but maintenance was the primary reason. And nine, and most importantly to Anderson School, the site exceeds the 5-acre maximum imposed by OPDWWD for the siting of these facilities. And their determination was made that this site would exceed, not only is unsuitable, but would exceed their budget for this. So that's the reasons why they reject it.
Okay. And so you'll see that we do have on the agenda tonight a recommendation to request that they examine an alternate site, and that is 81, I think.
81 South, 80, Quaker.
81 South Quaker.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And we did check that that was under the 5-acre limit, and it's on a county road, which alleviates the traffic concerns. So,
yep. Okay. So, would anyone like to comment on any of the resolutions before us?
Hi, good evening. Steve Ackerman from Connolly Drive. First, on behalf of the residents of Connolly Drive, I'd like to thank the board for hearing our concerns, especially about the serious safety issues at our intersection with Route 9G. And I have a handout of this as well. Our intersection Route 9G and North Cross Road regarding the siting of the community residents on our street and recommending an alternative site. We appreciate it. Appreciate that. From the beginning, we believed that 55 Connolly Drive was a poor choice for a group home for a number of reasons. It doesn't appear that the Anderson Center considered in particular the serious public safety issues at our intersection. The existing traffic issues would already pose a well-documented danger to current residents. The Anderson site would add significantly to the overall traffic load on Connolly Drive, thus increasing the danger to all, including Anderson's residents and staff. We're glad the town did the right thing by working on and suggesting at least the one alternative location. Anderson has rejected the initial Pinewoods Road recommendation, and we're grateful to see that the town is suggesting a second alternative at 81 South Quaker via resolution on tonight's agenda. However, only a single alternative site is included in the resolution. So we studied the Padovan law, and it does allow a municipality to offer more than one site at a time. The plain language of section C1B states that a town can, and I quote, suggest one or more suitable sites within its jurisdiction which could accommodate such a facility. So in order to more quickly bring closure and to help Anderson finding a suitable and safe location, we'd ask the town to amend tonight's proposed resolution to include more than one alternative site. We have some additional sites in mind. I understand from the proposed resolution, and as we just heard, that Anderson provided reasons for rejecting Pinewoods. But despite our best efforts to get those before tonight's meeting, we hadn't got them until just a few minutes ago. We were trying to get them so that we could understand them and then react and possibly consider other alternatives, alternative sites. Our local real estate agent, Diane Crittenden, who spoke at the last meeting, has been keeping track of real estate listings. I don't think she was able to make it tonight, but we have someone else who's going to talk to what we think of as our the top three alternatives. And then as an alternative to making a quick decision tonight about whether to add any more sites, we'd like to offer a small group of volunteers to work on this between now and say next week, which would be before the October 5th deadline. You have 15 days to get back to Anderson. And we'd be glad to help out in an effort to find suitable alternatives. As for some of Anderson's objections, they mentioned the creek, but at Enderkill Drive there's a pond, so they've dealt with water issues. The deck, a deck can be rebuilt. They're going to invest a lot of money in upgrading 55 Connolly. And the asking price at Pinewoods is lower than what 55 Connolly was. So I think, there's budget room there to do things like fix the roof, replace windows. Septic may be a difficult challenge. Oh, and then we were kind of speculating what could have been some of the reasons for objecting to Pine Woods. And we thought maybe the size of the lot. So we checked 91 East Meadowbrook Lane, which Anderson owns, is on 7+ acres. Lamory Road, which is another group home, is on 10 acres. 368 Allen Road on Salt Point Turnpike, which Anderson owns, is on 15 acres. So I don't understand the 5-acre limit. Thanks.
Well, thank you. Can everyone please try to limit their comments to 3 minutes and try not to be too redundant? I mean, certainly the Absolutely. Lot of points have been made regarding the traffic and
yeah, my promise. Promise not to cover any of those.
Thank you.
Okay, Paul Cantor, 33 Connolly Drive. Picking up on what Steve's comments, our whole approach is really to try and find a suitable and better alternative, and not just go into a round robin where opportunities that we throw out are just tossed out of hand. And in keeping with the multiple sites that we're recommending, Diane, who is our real estate agent who couldn't make it tonight, has come up with 3 sites, and as Steve said, there's no limit in the number. It does not be one at a time, and we just think if we could get a group committee and try and get the best brains moving forward, we could come up with something. And she has come up with 3 sites that I'd like to, or she is proposing, and I would like to propose them on her behalf. One is 109 Havland, the second is 54 Bedard, and the third is 171 Cardinal Road, and I will give you the full listing. But the Bedard home is close to amenities in town, has an evacuation room, has 8 bedrooms, 2 in the first floor, lots of open space, a finished basement, and fenced in rec tennis court on 1.71 acres. The 109 Havlin Road is 4+ bedrooms, 1 at least on the first level, possibly more could be added inexpensively. Laundry, kitchen, laundry, large area in the first level, and a 3.8 acre, so that one falls in. And then lastly, 171 Cardinal Road, which is a 4-bedroom, 2.5 bath on 2+ acres with a large attached garage, which it's on the first level and maybe exactly the same way that the Anderson folks are gonna add bedrooms at the Connolly. And there's an extra room off the back of the house for possible conversion. So again, and these are all on streets that are eminently safer and better. And the first two were looked at by folks in the neighborhood who have special needs. Kids are thoroughly expert in needs. And this isn't just some broker's ideas. They've been vetted and they do have professional backing. So I'll just give you each a copy and hope that you can amend it so we can give the Anderson folks a bigger menu to choose from. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, would anyone else like to speak?
Thank you.
Thank you.
I would like to thank the board. I'm Barbara Streitman from 35 Connolly Drive, and I would like to thank you for working on this. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else? Okay, so. Oops. Oh, sure.
Did you want to? Oh, you were just
thinking out.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Okay, so it's a little bit of an alternative is being presented. I don't know if the board has any thoughts on that. How would you, Emily, want to start?
I mean, I'll just, I certainly appreciate the neighbors' interest in being constructive and trying to come up with some good suggestions. You know, my concern really is that it puts the board in an awkward position to choose locations in the town where if we recommend them, and Anderson does choose one of them, then those neighbors do not get any say in it. And I'm just really concerned that any of the locations that are more on a town road in a neighborhood type setting just have the potential for first introducing traffic concerns in another location and also potentially having neighbors in those locations raise concerns that would not have the opportunity to be addressed. So when I looked over the list that was provided, I really felt that the locations on county roads were more appropriate in that they were on a more heavily traveled road where you didn't have that same sense of a neighborhood and where the traffic could easily be absorbed. So that's why I really felt comfortable with this 81 South Quaker location, and I'm a little concerned about choosing one that's on a town road. I mean, that being said, Anderson has access to all the listings of all homes that are available for sale, and they can certainly look at those and change their mind at any time. So that's just what's going through my mind right now.
How many homes, Warren, can we offer up?
The statute doesn't appear to limit the numbers, but I think the way I read the statute and the decisional law, we get two bites at the apple. So we put in our first recommendation, if we want to put in more than one, we can't. There have been some cases which said that you can't keep submitting sites, that after the second, that's it, although it's not written in the statute. So if you were going to propose more than one site, I would recommend that it be done in this resolution rather than take a chance on another resolution. And I am concerned about the 15-day time period. I thought that expired more quickly, but do you remember when it
I'm not exactly sure of the
I
date.
I think it depends if it's business days or calendar days. If it's
it
calendar
days,
I think that it's yeah. really only 2 weeks yeah. from
I don't have the yeah. date that we received the feedback from Anderson. I think that was
I thought it was the Friday before last.
That's what I thought too. Yeah. I'm not sure what date. You don't have your calendar? Well, anyone else? Or should I Dave?
Yeah, I hate to throw this back at Anderson. It looks like we're just, there's another card, you know, and we're picking neighborhoods, but we're not really. This was suggested by the people on Conley Drive, these other, is there four of them here?
Three.
There's three, okay. And I just asked Warren aside, same question Kenny asked, how many, you know, houses or homes can we put up? And he answered that. And there's a strict time limit. So this would, if we do this, if we change it to these, well, is the one on here that we have tonight?
No.
Okay, the three homes listed here, they don't have the one we have on Quaker Lane tonight. So I don't know. This will be the last time we do it, I think. You just can't shuffle around and say this neighborhood, that neighborhood. Right. Not that we're picking neighborhoods, but it's Anderson's call. The state made the law to prevent communities from saying, no, not here. And, you know, I agree with that. They don't have a voice, and they needed a voice.
Well, I know the Haviland Road, we can eliminate immediately because there is a pond for fishing. And the water issue is that there's two gentlemen that their site is extremely impaired. And so that's why there's restrictions for water at this residence.
All right.
So based upon what we've heard of the residents that would be living in the home, two are extremely impaired. And that's why they don't want water in that for that. So.
All right. But, well, if we do change the resolution tonight, this will be the last time, right? I understand, Warren, that's correct.
That would be my opinion.
Yeah, we have to come to an end to it, so I really have to accept Anderson's word on the Pine Woods Road. I didn't visit it. I know the area, it's certainly rocky in there.
Right, and we can put down deed art if you like, but there's a pool there, you know, and again, there's water, so.
In-ground pool?
Yeah, so you're gonna have to look at Cardinal Road.
the decision tonight is, do we change the resolution?
Right. We have.
Right. I'm just looking at the at what they.
We have selected 81.
Right.
Quaker.
Quaker.
Because, as Emily said, the traffic implications are certainly less because of the volume of traffic that's there. That seemed to be very important to the neighbors. And, you know, my position is I don't want to be choosing one neighborhood over another. We're going down a slippery slope here. That's really my feeling. You know, Anderson has made the selection based on their evaluation of their needs. And, you know, I try to distill it down to its elements. And this, when the state describes this as a single family use, that kind of just changes the perspective, in my opinion, because, you know, would you as an individual say, well, I don't think that person should buy it because they only have two kids and they shouldn't have a five-bedroom house? You know, those are criteria that if it's a single family use, we don't have the impact or the ability to say we know what your needs are. They're, you know, it's better if you guys do this. So I think that's one of the reasons that from the beginning it's been very challenging, because clearly we want to do what the residents want. That's important. That's why we're here. That's why we work hard. But at the same time, we're realists. Like, we're pragmatist, because we've had to be. And I don't want to play a charade here that we're just going to keep putting things out when Anderson knows what their needs are and that they have the ability to select them, as Emily said, from the list that exists. So I feel that we should just continue with what we have in the resolution and, you know, just put that forward to them, because we've taken a look at that. It's the area that has the least traffic input and the least changes to a neighborhood.
Yeah, well, we picked the committee from Connolly picked Pine Woods as the preferred one, and they've rejected that. So I can't see them going for another one, especially what Kenny said with the pond at one and the pool in the other. So I don't know. I think their mind, this is my opinion, I think their mind is made up to go to Connolly. So I would agree to offer them Quaker. If they turn that down, I think the writing's on the wall. I'm not opposed to a group home any place, but, you know, we're doing what we can for the community coming out en masse like this. I was impressed with that. The only reason I really decided to offer another one myself personally is because of the outpouring from the community. If it does go on Connolly, I think you people will enjoy it in time. It might take a little bit of time. And if the traffic gets unreasonable, you know, we can address that issue as we're going to do with 9G and the crossroad. But, you know, there's things you can do, like put speed bumps in every 10 feet or something. I don't know. I'm just saying there's things you can do for that. I don't think you're going to see it, but I don't know.
Okay. Joe, I don't know if you had any comments.
When we first got the list, did we send that to, help me remember, did we ever send that to Anderson?
We sent the entire list.
40 homes. Yes.
And they came back with what?
They said that we had sent it kind of informally, because that was what was indicated at that first public meeting, is that we could send,
right,
that there could be a dialogue and that we could send this an informal list. So that was provided to us. So we did and said, you know, here's the list that the neighborhood had provided, and their response is that we had to pick something definitive.
Okay.
And that was, I don't have the letter right in front of me,
yeah,
but that was my recollection that it was, and I thought that you had to pick one.
Yeah.
That was my impression from that.
That's where I was going with this.
Yeah.
When I read the response, I got the impression you had to pick one.
That
and then
was my impression,
pick another
too.
One.
Yeah.
I didn't think, you know, I heard what Steve Ackerman said, but from the response I got that I read, I thought you had to pick one.
Yeah.
That's where I guess I'm a little confused.
Yeah, so I mean, we did pick one. We suggested it, and that was the one that the neighborhood selected and thought would be the best. And, you know, I hear Steve's critique of their criticisms, but again, I kind of just go back to that idea of when it's been determined as a single-family use, that just changes the complexion of it to me, in the sense that, you know, we don't have necessarily the ability to say what their needs are, just like we wouldn't for another, as someone else who was using it as a single family. So, you know, that's already been determined. That was predetermined by the state. That's they took that, they made that decision, and that's not in our ability to change that. Right. So that is just, you know, my feeling on recommending a number of alternative sites, because in a way what we're doing then is we're pre-screening them for future. I mean, saying that, oh yeah, the town's okay with, you know, I just, it's not something that I feel strongly is our role as the town. I mean, we have done what we were asked. We're providing one additional based on the parameter provided by the residents, that they objected basically on traffic, because of that, that they felt their neighborhood should be exempt from this use because the traffic implications. So that, you know, the other concerns that were originally brought out, that the residents might be urinating there, or that their property values were going to be compromised, those issues seemed to fall by the wayside, and this issue on traffic was the one that seemed solidified by and presented to us. So I think we tried to take that information and not just use it for the Conley neighborhood, but for the entire town, that this is a parameter that seems to make sense. So we use that in the selection of Pine Woods because it is a busy road. I think that's what we're saying here with Quaker too. So that's my recommendation. I'm suggesting we put that forward. People can vote obviously how they like. And if it fails, then I guess we'll have to reconnoiter for the October 3rd meeting.
Yeah, I think that's the time limit.
Is that okay?
All right, good.
Okay, so then let's go forward with.
There was no other comments. Is it, we close comments.
I think we did, but I mean, people are well. Well, we could.
No, do we close comments?
No, I don't think so.
Yes. Don't think we did. Do we close the public comment? You don't actually formally have to do that, do you?
Yeah, talking about for the resolution.
Are there any comments on any of the other resolutions?
On the other resolutions.
Yeah. Any other resolutions?
Yeah. Oh, yes.
Comments on this resolution or no?
Yeah. Sure.
Okay.
Yep.
Yep.
I'm going to wear my.
I'm Terry Bertles. I'm at 22 Conley Drive. And again, I want to thank all of you for all of your help. And I know this has been a lot of work, and you've really, you know, really had to look into your heart and to decide how you're going to make your decisions. I've been to all of the meetings, and I think the one takeaway that I had from Anderson's meeting is that they said, we like to come into a neighborhood, improve the property, and then people are happy, you know, because we've done something for the town. Because let's keep in mind that, yes, it's a single family, but it's tax exempt. So they're not paying for snow removal, road repair, schools, anything like that. So that's kind of something that they could do as a give back. So obviously Conley Drive, all of our houses, we really try hard to maintain them. So I was hoping that when we offer them other homes, their budget is vast. You look at some of the houses that they already bought, they're huge. And they have a large amount of taxpayer dollars to repair these homes, as well as other income that they have from the residents that are paying to go to the school. So I would encourage you to offer them more than one, and saying thank you for trying to make our town a better place, to make it more beautiful. Because we are challenged. We are very challenged in Hyde Park, as more and more property is coming off the tax rolls. And there's a fewer and fewer people being able to pay the higher and higher tax. So I would thank you for the work that you've done. And I would encourage you to please offer more than one. They have a pond now. They love to fish. They love to participate in their yard. They like to be outside. I really enjoyed Anderson's presentation. So I would encourage you, please, to offer more. And just say, and also remind them, thank you for improving our town by buying homes that do need work. Thank you very much. I appreciate all their hard work. I really do. I know it's been a lot of hours and a lot of angst, and I do appreciate it. Thank you so very much.
Thank you.
Would anyone else like to speak?
How you doing? Steve Brady, 68 Connolly Drive. So as my neighbors say, you know, first of all, we appreciate everything you guys do, and we know it's a painful process for everybody. You're trying to get through it, trying to do the right thing for everybody. But just hearing some of the issues why they didn't want Pine Woods, about water, you know, I'm not sure if you guys really walked around Connolly, but there's an open pond. There's a pond there in Connolly. There's some streams, all which are very close to 55. So, you know, my concern would be their concern. You know, they're bringing up this one point, yet they're picking a home that has that same issue. So, you know, maybe they just didn't look into that. Maybe they should be brought to their attention.
Thank you.
I don't know if I get a second comment, but a couple of comments. Anderson responded on September 20th, rejecting Pine Woods. And I believe the law says 15 days after they reject is when the town has the chance to offer another alternative. So I believe that's how I got to October 5th. And then when we were researching how this law works, we came across other towns that have, they set up what they call site selection committees. So I'm not saying that we have time to do that or should do that, but again, we offer to do that on a short-term basis. But as a longer-term thing, you may want to consider that possibility, because this probably won't be the last time that Anderson or someone else offers or wants to build a group home in the town.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Yeah. Well, to speak to that point just a bit, because certainly we feel the pain of having properties off the tax roll at a very intense level, because we're charged with making our budget work. So, I mean, that is clearly also out of our control, right? I mean, it's not as if we can say, oh, you know, you can't do that. That's been permitted by the state. But, you know, just this intuitive feeling that I have regarding proposing a lot of homes, basically what you're saying to Anderson when you do that, and it's all a matter of public record, it's not just for Anderson, you're saying that all these homes are actually very suitable for community residences, right? I mean, we're providing them with a pre-screened list. Here you guys go, you know, here's some more homes for you. So that is kind of one of my concerns here too, that, you know, there's often unintended consequences to actions that you take. And, you know, again, we are very concerned about the tax implications and are hamstrung really by the state legislation on that. And so, again, that's just part of my reluctance to provide an additional three properties, because you're kind of pre-screening it and saying, yeah, well, you know, these are good. We think you should put them here.
Could I just make a comment on that? I'm just wondering, I just wanted to offer an idea that maybe in the letter recommending 81 South Quaker, we could put a line in there asking Anderson to take another look at the available properties in Hyde Park, especially any that may have been new on the market because of the concerns that have been raised, and to just ask them to take another look at what's out there and whether it might suit their needs. I mean, I really do have the same concern about us taking the role of pre-selecting homes in certain neighborhoods, and there are a lot of concerns about that and how those neighborhoods would react and what traffic issues might already exist. But I'm just thinking that that's something that we could put in the letter, that we recommend this one, but we ask them to take another look at the new listings and the available listings in Hyde Park.
And to emphasize that exactly what you said, that, you know, they could really be a great neighbor for us,
yeah,
and try to improve that homes that really need it.
But then it still leaves it in their court to figure out what meets their needs, and we're not taking that role.
I like that. I think that's, because again, like you say, there's just an aspect to this where it becomes then our choice, right? And that we have said this is where, what we think should be done. And that's not a role that we're really that comfortable in. And it's not the, all right, I think that we would do that.
John Bertels, 22 Conley Drive. Like you, Chairman Rohr, Supervisor Rohr, I had to watch the initial Anderson briefing via YouTube because I was actually out of the country at the time. So I didn't get a chance to interact with them directly. But I think part of what you're struggling with is you don't want to pre-select, and we're not actually asking you in the long term to get into pre-selecting homes for Anderson or anybody else. The difficulty that we've got is the shifting tide. When we were talking, when the people that were here with Anderson were talking to Anderson, they said, okay, we understand the law. We understand that we may do certain things and there are other things we cannot do. What are you looking for? Right? And the problem that we have is that Anderson is acting as judge, jury, and executioner in this entire process. They don't have to tell us what their needs are. They don't have to be consistent in what their needs are. And we understand that there's not going to be a specific set of things that you'll go down and you'll find a house or any property that conforms to all of them. But it's a little difficult for us to accept and to put you in a position, ultimately, over the long haul, that we have to provide alternatives when there's this shifting, nondescript set of needs, right? They sat here on that video and said how much their people love to fish in the pond. And now they're saying that water is eminently dangerous to their people. All right? All we're asking for is, as a town, we need to say, look, if you're going to be in this town, you have to work with us. You have to provide us with a consistent set of things that you're looking for so that they can be objectively looked at. Instead of, we've decided what neighborhood we're going to come into, and we know that we have the law on our side, and we don't actually have to provide any real logical or consistent argument for why the other properties are not chosen. Thank you.
That's very logical, what you're saying. And but the entity that took that right away from us as a community is the state. That right was taken away by mental hygiene law. And that's what we really are struggling with, is that right was predetermined by that law.
Just a question. Does the law state that they don't have to tell us what their criteria is for their properties?
It doesn't state that.
Then I don't think it's taken away from you or the community to ask them and say, we want, within the law, we want to know what your criteria is so that properties can be evaluated. Because otherwise, I agree with you. You can't be in the picking this neighborhood versus that neighborhood. But if we don't know what the criteria is, we don't know whether or not they have picked the best place that they can pick in the town.
Let me just say this one thing, that, and I actually have a lawyer here and a half a lawyer over there. I stole her joke from today. And correct me if I'm wrong, you lawyers, but if it's not stated in the law, then it doesn't mean, then it's not a, it's only what's in the law is what you have, right? They don't cover all potential possibilities. Right. So the law clearly states we have three options and that's it. I mean, and it doesn't cover all eventualities and it never will, right?
The law is not well crafted. I have to tell you that, and there's a reason probably for that. It does create a distinct advantage to the facility that is proposing the law in the site selection process.
And then it's backed up by case law as
well. The case law is miserable.
And
as I've told you before, I could not find a single case in which a facility that was identified by a provider was denied on the basis of overconcentration, which is almost an insurmountable burden. And the case law that I've seen on alternative sites is really the cases that have decided, the few cases that have decided, the courts have added an additional burden that if you were to have the commissioner make a decision, you'd have to demonstrate that the site that you're recommending is more suitable than the site that they have proposed. It's not in the law, but it seems to be something that the courts have imposed in their decision, which makes the threshold for challenging a site selected, to say the least, difficult.
Dave,
did you want to say
something? Yeah, I'm sorry, Dave. I didn't mean to cut.
Well, I'm not an attorney, but I sit between two of them, and I pick up a little bit. The law says we have to look at this as a single-family home, you know, and that's it. I moved into my neighborhood many, many years ago, and I didn't have to tell them, you know, what my priority, what I needed. If I did, they probably wouldn't let me in, but the thing is, that's it. They're single-family, and that's how we have to look at whether the law is written badly or not. That can be changed, you know, over time, but that's the way it says, and like Warren and everybody else has said, we're pretty limited in what we can do as a town.
I think the second page of the letter the initial letter we received had a second page that did have a list of criteria. So there is a documented list.
Yes. Oh, really?
In the initial, yeah.
Yes, you're right.
They have criteria on that.
Yeah. Oh, it was the second page of that
when
letter.
When initially sent it.
Yeah, we sent the copy out to the neighborhood. Yeah.
I think it was their requirement. There was no...
Not the town.
I don't know what
no,
the
No, it was Anderson's requirements.
Right.
Yeah.
All right, so
okay. I think, like I said, we'll go forward. It is a very awkward and unfortunate position to be in. The last thing we want to do is, you know, something that impacts people's perception of their neighborhood. But it's kind of a farce how the law was written.
We're doing the best we can.
Yeah, I feel like we are just doing the best we can and that's the truth. So, okay.
So we're skipping
ask for a motion to pull resolution number one, right? Okay, so.
Resolution 926-2 of 2016, resolution recommencing the local law adoption process for local law I of the year 2016, entitled A Local Law Amending the Town Code to Establish a New Chapter 130, entitled Solar Energy Systems and Facilities, and to amend the schedule of use regulations to provide for those facilities.
Second.
And all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. And
aye.
So again, the public hearing will be on the 17th.
Okay. Resolution.
We don't change the law.
Can we leave that as stamp? We voted right.
We're never going to pass this law. It's just going around and around.
Connie may be going around and around. Resolution 926-3 of 2016. Resolution receiving proposed local law number J, entitled letter J, actually. A local law amending chapters 96 and 108 of the town code to provide for the abandonment of certain stale applications before the Town of Hyde Park Planning Board.
Second.
And all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Resolution 926-4 of 2016, appoint temporary part-time cleaner for highway and recreation.
And a second?
Second.
And all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Resolution 926-5 of 2016, appoint temporary part-time clerk building department.
And we have a second? And all in favor?
Aye.
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 Resolution 926-6 of 2016, resolution acknowledging the resignation of part-time municipal secretary in the building department.
Second.
And all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Resolution 926-7 of 2016, resolution acknowledging resignation of part-time police assistant.
Second.
And all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Resolution 926-8 of 2016, resolution authorizing the town supervisor to execute a new collateral agreement with Key Bank.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Resolution 926-9 of 2016, a resolution authorizing the issuance pursuant to section 90.00 or section 90.10 of the local finance law of refunding bonds of the town of High Park, Dutchess County, New York, to be designated substantially public improvement refunding serial bonds and providing for other matters in relation thereto and payment of the bonds to be refunded thereby.
Oh, okay. And this is just to allow us to refinance our debt.
Yeah, it's always funny how it says refund, but it's really refinance.
Yeah, wouldn't it be nice?
Refunding anybody.
Really?
Second. I need a second.
Second.
And roll call, please.
Councilwoman Stinson.
Aye.
Councilman Ray.
Aye.
Councilman Marine.
Aye.
Councilman Schneider.
Aye.
And Supervisor Roark.
Aye.
Resolution 926-10 of 2016, resolution authorizing the attendance of Barbara Hobins at the Greater Hudson Heritage Network Annual Conference at Locust Grove on October
28th.
Six. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Resolution 926-11 of 2016, resolution authorizing the attendance of Kathleen Davis at the Sustainable Trails for All workshop October 12th through 13th, 2016.
And
second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Resolution 926-12 of 2016, resolution authorizing the zoning administrator Kathleen Moss to carry over accrued vacation time.
Second.
And all in favor?
Aye.
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 Resolution 926-13 of 2016, resolution scheduling a public hearing to discuss the intended use of community development block grant funds for 2017.
Okay, just to give everybody an update, Emily and I have been working on this behind the scenes a little bit. We're exploring using the economic development component of the CDBG grant, and that would enable the town to apply for funds for a business that would hire people that are from the low to moderate income group. So we're exploring a couple of options. Actually, today I was talked with the owner of the property that's just north of High Park Elementary, who has submitted an application to build a bed and breakfast at that location. So the plans are beautiful and obviously a very expensive proposition. So I talked with him regarding this concept that the town could apply for these funds. Is for every job created, there is a $10,000 possibility of for a grant. You have to actually for every half of all the jobs created. So I talked with the gentleman. He felt he was a little early in the process for him to do that. But we'd like to just let people in the general public know that this is something that we're exploring, and you know, if they have a business or a building that they're planning on renovating, and that they will be employing people for low to moderate income people, that they should call and we'll you know, discuss an application with them.
Great.
So you know, this is a novel. We've reached out to Ann Saylor, the manager of this program for the county, and they haven't really done any of these, but you know, for the community, that is really what we need, is we need people to be investing in their buildings, we need businesses to come in, and so if we can do that, we will. Another alternative, if we're not able to come up with a project in that regard, is to resubmit the Pine Woods application that we did last year, and we can modify it. Downsize it a little bit and modify it, because hopefully with the new owners of the Amish market, there will be something built there, and we can, you know, that was, and if anyone has any other ideas, we'd love to invite you to come out to the public hearing that we have scheduled for the 3rd of October. You know, these are funds that are either for parks or low to moderate community areas. We've built a number of sidewalks with them. So, you know, we're eager to embrace ideas that are put forth for realistic projects. Did you have anything to add to that?
Okay.
Can I just mention that if I probably won't be able to get this published in the paper until Friday. Does that give you enough time by doing it Monday? Gives you 3 days in the paper?
No.
So we need to do it on the
17th?
Give me 5 days.
Is the 17th adequate in terms of the timeline for CDBG?
I'm not sure.
So the problem is if we do it on the we don't have enough time for publishing it.
Is there another meeting? I thought we had one on a Wednesday or something.
Yeah.
Oh, do we? For the budget?
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I'm begging.
Somebody have that on their schedule?
It's on my calendar.
So
October, right?
5th, it would be. Well, do we have it? Do we have it on the
12th? Yes, we have one on the 12th. It's a Wednesday.
It's a Wednesday.
Oh, the 12th is a Wednesday?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Let me look at when we have, because then we also have to have a resolution to vote on the application. So I'm guessing the 12th is going to be okay.
Is Pete back?
He's back,
he
yeah.
He knows the timelines.
I know.
So check with him in the morning just to make sure we're okay.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, but we need
what if
to
we're not, so.
Maybe he'll come up with a suggestion. Well, let me know. I'll be in the office in
okay.
the morning. We'll figure out yeah. something.
Okay, but right now we're going to say it's the 12th?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
But we've confirmed that we've got that meeting scheduled.
That's what I have okay. on my calendar,
I have it
yeah.
set aside on my calendar.
Okay. All right, and we think that's enough time.
But
so
9 p.m. is not.
You know what? If we had to do a separate meeting, that's just what we would have to do.
Yeah. Right? Yeah.
No.
Okay. But the 12th is adequate time, right?
Okay.
Okay, so
thanks, Donna.
Thanks for thinking of that. So just a we just have to modify. Do we need a motion to modify the resolution to reflect the 12th?
So moved.
Second.
And all in favor?
Aye.
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 And now we can vote on the resolution.
Right.
Do we already have a second?
Second.
And all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
I'm sorry.
It's okay.
Is that me? Resolution 926-14 of 2016, resolution recommending second alternative suitable site for a home as an individual residence alternative for 5 people with developmental disabilities pursuant to section 41.34 of the mental hygiene law.
Second.
And all in favor?
Nay.
Aye.
Nay. Nay.
Nay.
I'm not
Nay.
Voting for that.
Okay.
Just, you know, I was on record the last time that I was not in favor. You know, I actually had a parent come up to me at Stop and Shop in Hyde Park, tears in her eyes, and said, you know, I have a child with severe autism that has to be in a group home. And I understand the fear of the residents, but it's no different with traffic if you had a family with 5 children that all start driving at the same time. And I just have a hard time voting yes for something like this, based upon all the information that we've had. I understand the residents, the fear of the changing of the neighborhood, some of the traffic that is going to change there a little bit, but that can happen if you have a family of 5 children move in. And I said the last time, and I'm going to say it again, I walked in here with my head held high, and I'm walking out the same way, and my moral compass just can't go that way. So my vote is no, I can't do that. So
I respect that, Ken.
Thanks, Councilman. My turn?
I think so. Yeah.
Resolution 926-15, resolution authorizing the town clerk to solicit bids for the 2017 highway materials.
Second.
And all in favor?
Aye.
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 Resolution. Resolution 926-16 of 2016, resolution authorizing the town clerk to solicit bids for the 2017 highway contractual services.
Second.
And all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
In resolution 926-17 of 2016, resolution authorizing the town supervisor to sign a 1-year extension agreement for the Teen Center Intern Program and Teen Activity Center with the County of Dutchess.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay. I just want to make one comment. I was away this past week for my daughter's wedding, and just want to thank the deputy supervisor for doing an outstanding job.
Yes, she did.
And standing in and doing all kinds of work. So thank you, Emily.
Thanks, Em.
Anytime.
Well, next time they get married, I'm...
Do we have public comment?
No, because it shouldn't be on there, because that's...
I saw that public comment thing there.
Typically, we only have a public comment on the first meeting of the month. But, you know, if you want to, come on up.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay.
Sure, sure.
I'm sorry, you know,
No,
it's been a long meeting, and...
I'm so sorry, though. Yeah, that shouldn't... We just have general public comment the first meeting.
Well, fortunately or unfortunately, some of my readers didn't show up, so this will be a little truncated here. And you have what we were going to read in front of you, plus a resolution from the Orange County Legislature.
Just know, 3 minutes.
3 minutes, yep.
I'm going to talk as fast as I can. we're taking your time to ask you to protect your constituents from the depredations of national trade.
The mic.
I can.
Perfect. Perfect.
We're taking your time to ask you to protect your constituents from the depredations of trade policy, specifically the Trans-Pacific Partnership, or TPP, a free trade agreement involving the United States and 11 other Pacific Rim countries. Now, you know, your citizens, they don't want to be bothered by boring details of street repair, zoning, city repairs. City planning, usually you'll only hear from them with individual problems at tax time. Well, the same thing goes for national trade policy. They're not experts in this. Unfortunately, in this area, their elected representatives on the national level have been failing them, and I can even say betraying them, for the last 40 years. Now, in these free trade agreements, there you have this dangerous provision in all of them called Investor-State Dispute Settlement, or ISDS, which give away national, state, and local sovereignty. If there is a potential threat to their profits, ISDS provisions give foreign corporations the right to sue in supranational corporate courts and overturn national, state, and local regulations. Under ISDS, local governments could face challenges to their ability to buy local or buy American, to protect locally owned businesses, to limit urban sprawl, to protect their city's health and environment by excluding polluting industries or industrial overuse of water. Now, we've had over the centuries patriots fighting and dying for the right to be governed by laws made by them, by their own elected representatives, not kings, not foreign nations, or stockholders. Yeah, I'm even saying stockholders, because that tea that went into Boston Harbor was owned by the British East India Company. It wasn't little individual British tea merchants. And I want to memorialize a few of my ancestors who fought in the revolution. They're real people. Sage Churchill, Nathaniel Churchill, David Mather, Thomas McClune, Thomas Slade, Henry Hatcher, real names. And I feel that you and I have a sacred duty to honor their sacrifice by speaking out in every possible way against giving away those rights.
We have your information. We'll be more than happy to read through it. We appreciate your comments tonight, but your time is up, so thank you.
Pam will finish up here for us. Thank you.
Everyone needs to state their name and address for the record.
My name is Pam Krimsky, and I live in Highland. Do you want my whole address? I'll give it to you.
That's
490. Okay. So I'm going to just read half of this to you, because I know you're really tired. It's late. The truth remains that the Trans-Pacific Partnership offers no benefit at all to American workers, no benefit to American prescription drug users, no benefit to American internet users, and it overrides the American Constitution. What remains is the fact that it benefits some exporters and supranational corporations. The Trans-Pacific Partnership and the free trade agreements of the past 20 years are, in reality, simply massive giveaways for corporations. The TPP, in fact, was negotiated in secret with the advice and consent of more than 500 corporate advisors and with no input from Congress at all, which is charged by the Constitution to regulate commerce with foreign nations. So who is writing the rules? The corporations whose only allegiance is to profit, or the elected representatives of the American people. Our Constitution begins with "We the People." Its purpose is to promote the general welfare of the people, not to establish or support any form of domination over them, including corporate domination. As citizens concerned with protecting American liberty and American economic well-being, we're asking the town board for help in this task. Please pass a non-binding resolution declaring the town of Hyde Park should be a TPP-free zone, and lend the voice of the people of Hyde Park to the opposition for this agreement, which is an affront to everything we as Americans stand for. Thank you for your time. I know it's really late.
Thank you.
It's been a long meeting.
Yes, thank you so much.
Thank you. Thanks for coming.
Have a good evening.
Out.
Thanks for coming.
Okay, may I have a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Second.
And all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Oh, sure. Thanks
for
stopping.
Yeah, bye-bye now.
Good luck.
Thank you.
A lot of business. Thank you, Kenny.
Oh, you're welcome.
Can't have one here together.
He's just going to stop with Charlie and had over here.